people of faith like you turn to prayer? And how much has prayer helped in this situation?
It is the only thing that God hears, that we can go to Him. I think a prayer and devotion, but like just always having our thoughts concentrated, you know, like just prayer without ceasing, just always keeping our minds fixed. You know, to draw near to God, and because there's just so much for anyone. There's so much going on in these days, this day and age, and with the adversity people face, and we feel like we have our own adversity, but people suffer in many ways, and that we all, like, as we go through hardship, we really need to know that God is there for us, and that He brings us through. That He makes a way of escape, and He's the way, and that through Him He will give us strength, and strength for each day. So you know, we just can't get ahead of ourselves and be anxious about what tomorrow will bring. But each day, you know, His grace is He supplies, and but we do have to access it. So it's definitely you know, cooperating with the will of God. If we find ourselves in this situation today, then what are we gonna do? You know, are we going to are we going to have a pity party, or are we going to just do the best you can, you know, and look for, you know, we pray for relief, we pray that things will change, and we trust that, you know, our life is in God's hands, that He cares for us. So, prayer is, we, you know, is vital to the Christian life. Word of God. And many words in the Bible. Many friends in the Bible. Oh, he has many. Patriarchs, just different. Hezekiah, different. different men that were used over time, and women. The word is living, and we have the logos word, which is the written word. We have the rhema word, and it is alive. And it empowers us as we apply it to our life, not maybe just some dead letter on a book. You know, it is how it lives in our hearts, and it's how we can each of us apply it in our day, in our circumstance, because I can trust God right then, with a promise. And I can say, okay, if your word is true and it is, then you're trustworthy. So. We have the privilege of reminding God of his own word, and he loves it because we are, we're saying, Father, you gave us this. And we're bringing it to you and saying we know you're good for this word for us. And so he continually gives more. Yeah. Despite how we feel. temporal. You know, we're given a space and time in this life, and we don't know how long that will be. And as we are trusting God for healing, we also know that there is no fear in death. So we're not, you know, having faith just in healing. We're having faith in God, and that He, you know, that one day we will be face to face with Him. We want Him to say, you know, good and faithful servant. We want Him, we just probably won't even stand before Him. We'll just be on our faces. I mean, you know, really, with eternity in view, that is how we get through our day, because the eternity is a long time. When we're before His Majesty, all this will just be a faint, I don't even know, it won't really matter, but we will bring the works done through Christ. We will bring that into heaven with us, you know. The 14 years now, so he's long past. He's tripled longest expectation of the 5 years. Just by the grace of God, like I was just really been a day by day thing, but now 15, you know, approaching 15 years by the end of this year. What are we the most thankful for? Well, I would have, there's much to be thankful for in our the way God cared for us. I would say the most notable thing is the whole expression of our immediate family, our family unit, our children, the way they all help with her father, and the way that they have, they're intuitive to notice other people that have limitations. One of our daughters is an interpreter, a sign language interpreter, but just all, I think it's enhanced their, you know, view of the world, and they also are fighters. They've had to live. They come home to this. There's always been this uncertainty. Scott's feeding tube surgery, his tracheostomy in 2009, just all these times where it was very, very ominous that things weren't going to continue. He was going to be able to continue. They've lived with that, which could have been a very weighty thing. But they just, it hasn't weighed them down. They've lived life and pursued their dreams, their education, and you know what they hope for in the future. So I'm really, really very proud of them, and I'm proud of Scott for just every day that he commits his heart and he commits his day that just to be used of God. And because he doesn't quit, I don't quit. And I couldn't quit.
So, most of us contend the phrase is sickness and health. What has helped you guys so far?
God. This is the grace of God. But we made our vows before God. And that was a vow before God. A threefold cord. And it's not easily broken. And Christ is in the midst of our relationship. And that's where all disagreements have been settled. Even if it takes some days to get there. Because just like any family, any marriage, you're going to have disagreements. But but it's settled at the cross where our flesh has to die and we have to learn not to react and be so reactionary. But I mean, this takes time, for relationships to come. But I feel like we've become, the one flesh. I feel like together we're more a demonstration of who each of us are than when one of us is apart. When I'm apart from Scott, he really can't expressed as well because of the physical limitations. But then when I'm by myself out, at the store or wherever, I don't feel like really knows me unless they see me with my family, with my husband, because this is who I am. My identity is with the work that God's doing our life, and just to be out and look maybe self-sufficient or independent or doing different things. That's not who I am. I'm very dependent. I'm dependent on Christ for my day, and all the goodness that he supplies, because our lives can change instant, and so, you know, what we have here, it may seem, you know, tragic, but it could be much, much worse. And I know around the world, people face many, many tragic things and persecutions and even martyrdom for faith. And so I feel like we have a very, very privileged to be in this country, in this place, and be surrounded with loved ones and the help that we have. Chapter 2, that I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but not I, but Christ that lives in me. In him. And you know what? I've witnessed that other people say that to us, but many times when he just cannot go anymore, I say, but we told, you know, we said we were going to be there. We're going to. He will allow God to quicken him, and he really doesn't feel like it. But in obedience, he goes. You know, and then in the going, God does strengthen him, and then it works out that he does fine, and we didn't, we get back and we go, wow, we wouldn't have gone, but judging by the way you seem to be, you know, feeling, but because we knew that God commissioned us to go, then in the going, he strengthens. Did you have something you were saying? We went to Phoenix last week in March of last year, 2010, we were gone for 10 days. And this was on the, it worked out that it was the end. anniversary of his 1 year from his trachea surgery. And I mean, we didn't know that he would survive the trachea surgery. Yeah, we drove down there. And it took us 3 days, 2 nights. So it was a lot of work because we had a lot of stuff to bring into the hotel and out again. And you know, and he didn't carry any of it. I did have a daughter with me on the way down and on the way back, but you know, we just really knew that we were to go, and you know, we look back and we go, wow, you know, how did that even happen? But we're planning to go again. And it seems like, are you crazy? Well, yeah, I guess so. Because we're going to, I mean, we don't just on the whim think we should go do these things, but if we feel that God is urging us to do something, then we'd rather do that than forfeit what was there for us to find out that, you know, he has for us. So. Believing for the impossible. That's hope. And, you know, I always think about the verses that says that, you know, God's given us a future and a hope. You know, hope for our future. Like, why do we feel like that can be robbed from us when there's given, you know, a diagnosis? You know, the enemy wants to rob, kill, and destroy. And he wants to take away your very life. you're given today. So why do we allow him to have that power and influence over us? He doesn't have dominion over that. Because it's been paid for, we can live in a resurrected life. We don't have to, there is a victory. We don't have to say, you know, is the end, you know, there is nothing for my future because it's so bleak. But you just be surprised as you lend your life to God that he, you know, work in and through you and take you to places that and take you to places and different adventures that you would never have thought were possible.
And the relationships that
well, of course, people are in our culture very busy, and it takes time to visit with Scott because you have to be very patient, and we appreciate you all coming today because we're not that happening people, you know, we're not going out to dinner and we're not going on a cruise, we're not doing these things that people might like to do or meet one another out places. We're actually kind of shut in much of our day, and as I mentioned, I work downstairs, so I'm like here 24/7, and but so our relationships have changed because people are, you know, busy with their own lives, work, families, and Well, there's many. But I feel like our relationships are deeper. I feel like our walk with God is deeper. There's truths that we learned, you know, over decades of actually theology, you know, things that we've known, we've been through Bible school, but you can know things up here, but not necessarily here in your heart. And then you go, well, systematic theology, you know, I don't know if I agree. But really, it's simple. It's the gospel of good news that Christ came. And he gave his life a ransom for us. And you know, we're set free. And it's a simple message that we can commit our lives to Jesus, our Savior, and then through Him, we can have the comfort and of future and of hope. We can have a hope for eternity. And we don't have to strive in the flesh to be good enough to perform to know enough. You know, we can just rest in our relationship with Christ, and that I think is bigger than we even know. Just to be able to trust Him for our breath, just trust Him with our lives, and so the positive aspects are our deep walk with Christ, I would have to say, and just knowing that when things look bleak, it's not over yet. It's not over until God says it's over, and He numbers our days, and no man, no doctor, no one can project that to you. You know, and so we don't how many days each of us have. So we have to redeem the time, and we have to make the most of each day.
Has that been a book you've read, a conversation?
Friend Natalie Nichols. She is a had chronic Lyme disease, and she introduced us to a preacher man that she listened to and received much encouragement from. His name was Manly Beasley from Texas. He was like a revivalist, but he also withstood of physical illness, but had amazing faith, and she is the same, like she overcomes much during her day and the years that we've known her. Her website is Shades of Grace Ministry. But what she brought to light for us was a problem that it seems to be, you know, many Christians face, that when you're so occupied with like that you believe that God can heal. So I believe that God can heal, so, and I believe he could heal me, but what do you do if he didn't heal you today? You know, like, are we just gonna be so consumed with the healing that we can't really you know, praise him today? We're just so consumed, because what if it's years, as it has been, you know, over from some of our Bible figures, you know, like years before our promise kind of came to pass. Okay, so we believe God is a healer. We know he can heal. But we don't know what his plan is or his timing. So what are you going to do in that space of time? And I think that in some Christian thought is that you don't have faith if you're not like really working toward that healing, but it's not true. You had to be at rest that God, you know, God can do that work, but it's in his hands.
How will you encourage someone diagnosed with
just to be in the Word of God. To draw near to God and in his Word. To believe God over what you hear.
How long did it take for you to be able to understand? How did you figure this out? I don't know how.
I don't always get it right. He thinks I ad lib some, but I, you know, we've been married 27 years next month, and you know, I know him very well. We have fellowship together. We hear the same messages together. You know, I share books that I'm reading with him. Like, so I So that's part of it. And I'm used to hearing him, so I don't get it right many times. But then he also will spell with his feet if I need more clarification. And when he's in by his computer, he will type. He will type it on the Word document or whatever, anything he wants to tell me.
I think that's so much, Lenny and Scott, Brody, for this great opportunity to be able to share your story.
Thank you so much. Appreciate
it. Thank you, Scott. Thank you, Glennis. Until next time, please don't give up hope.